All right, welcome back from that short break and this particular part of Kachai. I'm going to have a conversation with a colleague of mine. He works at New Vision, but also took a trip down to China. He has experiences he has got from there. And in case you haven't noticed, China is the new Western world for Africa. Welcome with me, Mubarak Mugabo. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome back from China.
Thank you very much.
How do they greet in Chinese?
Ni hao. How are you?
And how do I respond?
You just say ni hao.
Ni hao.
Yes.
Ni hao.
Yes.
And then say ni hao.
Ni means like you.
Mm.
How?
Mm.
Are you okay? Are you fine?
Mm.
Yes.
So how does that mean I'm fine? Or is it how are you? How
it's,
are you?
It's just how are you? How are you? Like if you want to translate it directly in English, it would mean that possibly. Yeah.
How long did it take you to learn some of these Chinese, you know, the language and also adopt to the culture?
Look, I went to China in last year to attend the China Africa Press Center program, which is an international center that brings together international journalists to look into perspectives in how the world is moving, how the world is evolving, and probably learn a lot about international politics, economics, and how China maybe relates to the rest of the world. And by the time they take you there, you can spend about 2 months to get to know how to speak it, because the center is based in Beijing, which is in the north of the city, or rather of the country, and English is something scarce. So if you want to buy something to eat, something to drink, you have to know how to play around with the language, and then yes, that's how fast you can get to learn about it.
So in 2 months, you could ask for something to eat. And you could probably check into a hotel and...
No, it's not a hotel, it's a university, it's called Dreaming University.
Mm.
But of course it has apartments, diplomatic apartments that caters for international journalists.
Mm.
And the area around, because you have to cook for yourself, you have to prepare meals for yourself. As you know, we are from different cultures, given the cultural differences. So you have to go to supermarkets, buy things, buy stuff from, you know, vendors. And these vendors do not speak a simple English, so you only have to play around with your Chinese,
you're using sign language and
you sometimes get fed up of sign languages. Yes.
Let's talk about you as a Ugandan who was raised here, taking a trip to China. What's the shift like? What's the difference between China, specifically where you are, and, you know, the Kampala here? In terms of livelihood?
Livelihood, there is a lot. There's a lot in difference, because China itself is the most populous country, I think, in the world. People are are many. In the city alone, like Beijing, you find around 30 million people, which is nearly Uganda's population. And then the life there is, because the population is big, there is no joke. All the time is work. So you rarely find people, you know, on the streets doing gossip and whatever. People are working, people are very busy, people are very serious. So when you get there, you realize that you also have to be very busy, because there is nobody there to talk to you, to speak to you, to waste time, you know, speaking about Arsenal, Man U and all that. So it's completely some different environment, like from Uganda. But another thing is that the Chinese people, because they don't so much know Africans, like Africa is so far from, given the geographical location, Africa is so far from China. So they really want so much to understand Africa, and the same applies to us. We also want to understand them, because when you talk about Chinese, you think about a lot of negative things that the Western media always report about them. But it's completely different, unfortunately.
Completely different.
Completely.
When you talk about the Western media and how they represent China, and you know, the fact that has been roaming around the media that China has completely cut itself from the world in terms of the internet, in terms of media, how true is that, first of all? And then secondly, what is there in China that we are not seeing?
First of all, is that for the last 70 years, when China was formed, there has been, taking you back to the history, is that during the formation of the United Nations, which was dominantly, run by the United States and the Western colleagues, the Europe, China wasn't in existence. There was what they called the Republic of China, which is Taiwan, because remember that at that time, China had been occupied by the Japanese. Mm. But then a few years, that was around 1945, a few years after, 2-3 years, then there was that China Civil War that brought in the formation of the People's Republic of China, which is currently in, which made 70 years last year. Mm. There has been a misrepresentation of facts in China, because the Western media tends to appreciate the Republic of China, which is Taiwan, yet Taiwan, in real terms, is a province of China. It's not a country in itself. So there has been a misrepresentation of facts, starting from the way Chinese live, the way Chinese relate, and the development path, or the economic model that Chinese people or the Chinese government chose to take. So I think it's only of recent years that Chinese government, resolved to start telling its true story, and who the Chinese are and their interests. Mm. Yeah.
And now we are here. Let's talk about the journalism, and let's start from what did you unlearn, in order to learn new things. What did you reach there and say, okay, I think I was wrong about this? And you picked up a few ideas there. What was the first thing you said? No, I think this. I was wrong on this.
The one. Western media always talk about violation of human rights. Mm. As a student of law, I thought I was going to be, persecuted on the streets. I thought, I would not even be able to speak out my views. I would not be even able to access social media, which is completely taken the trend in the world. I thought the media is gagged. I thought there is no space. There is no space for freedoms of associations and freedoms of expression. Mm. Unfortunately, I found it different. And I was so disgusted. I was only asking myself, wait, what was the impression? What was the motive of telling us that China is like an authoritarian,
dictatorial
setup. Mm, mm. But look, it's completely different. Mm. China has its own way of managing society. Mm. The same applies to the West. The only problem that we have, we Africans, is that we have not moved away from colonialism. Mm. We have not moved away from looking at the West as superior from us. But China tells you that, look, you can be something great, because in 70 years, China has moved from the poorest country in the world to the second largest economy
in the world. Of course, you are posting some pictures online as you were in China on Facebook, and some of us were saying, okay, how are you doing this? We thought it was only WeChat in China.
No.
And now you're posting on Facebook. Yeah. But how is your experience like in terms of one of the biggest conversations in the world, and that's climate change? Recently, if you see pictures coming in from China, people are wearing masks during the day, and it's so cold during the winter. How is the climate change conversation in China?
I think China is one of the countries that really that came up with strong regulations to make sure that there is a safer environment for everybody. Mm. True, there is pollution in Beijing, there is pollution in Chinese cities, but in a few years there has been a lot of policies put in place to make sure that this is rectified. When you go to Beijing today, it's a completely different story. When you go to Shanghai, when you go to Guizhou, when you go to Guangzhou, when you go to Sichuan, when you go to different Chinese cities, Hong Kong and Macau, it's a completely different story. Chinese government is really serious about this, and a lot of things have been made, a lot of steps have been taken to make sure that there is a clear, environment, a clear tackle for climate change in the future, And actually, it's only the Chinese government in the whole world that emphasizes a future for mankind, for everybody, a country that, everybody is equal, everybody is enjoying, and everybody does not find it so hard to live.
Are the world journalists the ones that are making a mistake in terms of misrepresentation? Because all we see is cheap products from China, very old cars exported to Africa. Yeah. And that's what we see. And we see China as a very polluted overpopulated country. Do you want to blame that misrepresentation on the world journalists, or do you want to say that China is protecting its good part from the outside world?
I think every country has weaknesses. Every country has problems. Every country has advantages.
Mm.
The misrepresentation of facts, you cannot blame it to anyone because the West, the way it reports on China, has its own interest why it reports it in that direction.
Mm.
The biggest task on us as African journalists and even journalists from different continents is how we perceive China, how we want to look at it.
Mm.
The way we look at the West, if you want to use the same glasses to look at the West,
you look at it differently
because obviously the biggest media is being controlled by the West.
Mm.
For example, I will give you an example. Look at Pyongyang, look at North Korea.
Mm.
Do you know anything good about North Korea?
No, we just know they have a lot of nuclear power and the president just bombs wherever they want.
You see, but do you read this from the North Korean media?
No.
Because you read it from the Western media. You read it from media that is not controlled, but that you know, we have not given North Korea the chance to talk or to speak, to represent itself.
Mm.
Why do we expect the US to tell us its story through CNN and its media and Fox? And then we don't allow North Korea to talk about itself with its own media.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, I'll be humbled if you told me that you took some time to move around the places of China, because the next question is about products.
Yes.
When someone says made in China, we think cheap and fake products. But when you look at the broader perspective, the likes of Apple, the likes of the internet providers and whatnot, all these guys are now moving to base their factories in China.
Mm-hmm.
On the ground, what is there? Are these guys just giving us fake products in Africa and keeping the good products for themselves? Or is there, you know, level of productivity not yet world class for us to appreciate good products?
It all starts with who tells the story.
Mm.
Yes, it all goes back to who tells the story.
Mm.
Because I don't think you get these stories from CGTN or from CCTV or from China Radio International.
Mm.
You get these stories from people who have their own interest of discrediting China in the eyes of the rest of the world.
Mm.
But look, the reality is, I would not be fooled to think that China is making better, very, very better products than those made in the US.
Mm.
To be honest,
US
has been built for hundreds and hundreds of years.
Yes.
China is a story of 70 years, as old as some of the African countries, right?
Mm.
So the reality is the propaganda of, you know, of fake products is a propaganda instigated by those people who compete with China in the foreign markets. Mm.
But are you saying that China has, you know, good products and we're being misinformed? And that actually,
do you want to say that right now? Do you want to say that my suit is
your suit is actually very nice. So anyway, moving on to culture.
Yes.
You know, the cultural differences between Uganda and China. When we see Chinese here, we see people who are very humble, and every time they don't speak a lot, they just bend over and say hi. What's a cultural difference like? How did it take you? How much time did it take you to adopt into that kind of culture in China? Because they're very reserved people.
No, China is reserved because in their culture, as I told you in the beginning, that these people do not have time for gossip.
Mm.
These people are very serious people. They are people who wake up every early in the morning, like to work.
Mm.
It's a lot of work. In fact, in most of the Chinese cities, you really find clubs and all that. They are there. Mm. You know, you could, if you want them, they are there. But it's not something easy. It's not something common. So they are very, you know, their government made sure that people go to work every early in the morning.
Mm.
Then in terms of culture, China itself is a very big country. A very big country. In fact, you can compare it with continents.
Mm.
China sits on a land area of about 3 million square, close to 4 million square miles, which is about a third of Africa. Yeah,
so that's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot. So you even Chinese
they
have different tribes. They have different ethnicities.
Mm.
They are you know, depending on the province that you come from, because you'll find that a Hong Kong person behaves differently from the mainland person. Even in the mainland, you'd find that the southern Chinese is different from the northern Chinese,
the northern
or
Chinese.
The western or the eastern.
Even so it's pretty much the same thing as Uganda.
It's the same thing. Even they used to tell me that, you know, man, there is no Islam in you, not I, there is no Islam.
Are there mosques, though?
Behind the
Mubarak,
behind the U.S. embassy, about a few meters away from the U.S. embassy where I was residing, there is a whole big mosque in Beijing.
So it's freedom
and
of worship.
And I would go there every day. There are churches. There is everything. But because there is that person who wants to represent China in a different way, obviously, he will represent it in a different way, in the way that he feels maybe he will suit it his own interest. But there is nothing like weird about it. There is nothing like everything that is here is there. There is nothing that is there that is not here. The only thing that is not there, there is no joke.
There's no gossip. That's something
there is no gossip.
You visually
there is no joke.
Said it.
There is no joke. There is no joke politicians like the one you have, like these baby wines and whatever.
What's the difference between the politics of, you know, Africa?
There is no jokers. There is no political jokers in China, to be honest.
Recently, we had an artist coming out to want to point fingers at the leadership of China.
No. The artist that you're talking about, who is in Hong Kong, who is, you know, is being used by the West. Seriously, to try to challenge the leadership of China. But look, Hong Kong is a Chinese province. It's not a country. It's a Chinese province. The only problem that it came, it was so much infiltrated by Western influence. That's why they even use English and all that. The same applies because China has about 33 provinces.
Yes.
Now, within those 33 provinces, they have different, like, you know,
political
hierarchy. Yes, hierarchy.
Yes.
So Hong Kong and Macau are Chinese special administrative regions. So they have some kind of autonomy in themselves. So because Hong Kong came back to China in 1997 from the hands of the British colonialists, Macau came in 1999 from the Portuguese colonialists. So there is that kind of, again, inside
politics.
Yes.
Let's bring it down back to journalism and point the finger at ourselves. You're a journalist, and you went there on journalist purposes to unlearn and learn a few things here and there. What do you say about television? How is television there, and how is television in Uganda, and how can we change in order to, you know, probably compete with China?
Look, we can never compete with China. That's a fact. Because we are different, we are in different planets. We are living in a different world. China is living in a different, you know, a different culture, you know, setup. We also live in a different culture setup. Look, our television is not original. Our television is Western. I'm not talking about Uganda's television. I'm talking about the entire Africa's television. Entire African media. We think like Western people. We reason like Western people because the interference, the infiltration was too much. We were so much colonized that we even, the colonialism went into our heads, the colonialism went into our thinking, our minds, our foods, our style of living. But in China, China is like in a resistance war against colonialism. That's the difference. That's why it is being reported there negatively. Because China is saying, look, you are using a fork, I'm using a chopstick. Right?
If you come to my house, you'd use my chopsticks.
This is because when you come to my house.
Is it true that when you go to Chinese
and we should thank China because before US was so much arrogant.
Yes.
It would say we don't want this leader and this leader goes. We would say but today it's different. U.S. says, Ugandan leader, we don't want you.
He runs from China.
No, and China says, please go slow. yes, go slow.
Mubarak, as you get done, of course, there's a lot we can talk about. Yes. And I hope that after the show, I can sit down with you and talk about some of these things in China.
Yeah.
What is that one thing that you took from China? And you say, this is a lesson I will never forget in my life.
In China, that thing is hardworking. I have never seen a Chinese who is idle. I have moved to more than 18 Chinese provinces. I have not seen an idle Chinese.
Have you seen Ugandan idol? Where? Are Ugandan idol here?
Majority of Ugandans are idol.
Majority of Ugandans are idol. Thank you very much, Mubarak Mugabo, for that insight. And I hope that you can pick a thing or two about China and, for cut out the misrepresentation. And let's slowly learn to unlearn things in order to learn new things. We take a short break. And when we get back, Derek and Tina will be on the show. And we're talking about a very, very interesting love letter. Stay tuned.